Good morning.
Good morning, everyone.
My name is Joel.
And my name's David Harrington. I'm the location pastor here. Only the front row got to enjoy my psych out. Every time they slow a song down, I think it's my time to come up, and then they start singing again. Love you guys. Hey, we're just so glad you're here. If you're new with us, we want you to know what to expect. We're going to take the next 10-15 minutes to sing a few more songs together. If this is your first time, we would love to meet you. There's a big table out in the lobby called our Connect Point. We have a gift for you. There'll be a friendly face there after the service. And especially if you're looking to get connected in, we want to help you connect in. We want to make that as easy as possible. We're going to continue to sing together here.
Yeah, and one of the things, don't you love just coming into the house of the Lord just to encourage one another? Yeah. I mean, when you see your brothers and sisters in Christ, I mean, I look around and I see some people that we've gone through some stuff together, right, Axleys? I mean, if you can be around Brian and Tracy Axley for more than 30 seconds and not be encouraged, there's something wrong with you. And I look, and the hills, I mean, just, it's such a place of encouragement. And I don't want people to think I'm a hugger, okay? Don't think that. But come here, David. No. But how many people are encouraged by David and how he serves us, right? I mean, seriously.
I paid him to say that.
No, it's not in my notes to say that. But really, that should just be a part of our lives, right? As brothers and sisters in Christ, if you're new, just this is what we do. We encourage one another. But even bigger than that, mm-hmm. we're here to praise God.
Yeah.
Because he is worthy of our praise.
Yeah.
Because he offers a peace that passes all understanding. He offers mercy that's new every single morning. And I'm still trying to get my brain around that.
Yeah.
And I've walked with Jesus for decades and I still don't get it.
Yeah.
But I don't have to. He does. Mm-hmm. So praise the Lord for that. And he gives us a love everlasting. It's not earned. It's not based on what we've done, what we haven't done, all that stuff that can get us all twisted up in my mind for me. But his love's everlasting.
Yeah.
And so in 1 Chronicles, I'm going to try to do this smoothly, 16:8. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the people. Sing to him.
Yeah.
Sing praises to him. Tell of all his wondrous works.
Yeah, and that's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to tell of his wondrous works. And if you're new with us, that line about making him known, that our hope for you, our prayer for you, is that you know God this morning, is that you experience this God that loves you, that gave his life for you, and that we're singing about. So let's continue to sing together, church.
this week. I was reading in the scripture in John 17 when Jesus had been turned over to Pilate, and there was a conversation that he was having with Pilate, and Pilate said, "Don't you realize I can set you free or I can crucify you?" And Jesus said, "No, you can't. Because I serve a king other than you." And I think it's very important for us as believers to realize that we serve a different king. And he's, in the days ahead, he's going to call us to stuff, whether it's plant churches or sharing with people, or but he's calling us to do things that actually we won't want to do. I mean, I don't think Jesus wanted to die on the cross. That'd just be my guess. But he accepted it. He knew that it was God's will. And actually, because of that, we were set free. And so I just want to encourage you to realize you serve, if you're a believer, you serve a different king. And our life should reflect that.
Yeah, one of the ways that we can respond to what Carl shared is just to, if this word spoke to you, just realize you can declare things so circumstances don't rule your life. I mean, not even, you know, what Jesus said to Pontius Pilate, yeah, you've got authority, but you don't have the real authority. And so let's just as we continue in worship, we'll be singing about God reigning. Let's just confess that. Nothing can separate us from his love. Nothing is stronger than God. No, nothing can stand against us that God can't redeem to make us more like him. Let's just consider those things as we continue singing.
Thank you.
Church, let's give him praise. He's worthy of our worship, worthy of our praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. God, you overcame. You conquered Satan, sin, and death. They put you in a grave, and that stone rolled away. And you walked out alive. And you're seated at the right hand of the Father, interceding on our behalf. Right now in this moment, Jesus, there's no one like you, God. No one like you. No one is wonderful. No one is precious. No one is great. No one is good, God. I pray, Lord, where everywhere the enemy has gotten a foothold to deceive and undercut your goodness and your mercy and your faithfulness, God, we pray you break that in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray that our hearts would be open. And that these words we're singing would come alive in our hearts, God. The beauty of them, of what you have done and who you are. Jesus, we thank you. We can't thank you enough. We just go on. It feels so right to thank you. Say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus, for the cross. Thank you for the resurrection. Thank you that I'm hidden in you and not earning my way. Wonderful, wonderful are you, Jesus. We just pray, God, as we continue in our service, you be honored. In your name I pray, amen. Amen. Well, thank you again for being with us this morning. If I missed you on the front end, my name's David. I'm the location pastor here. This is a great moment to say hi to someone sitting near you and grab a seat, and we'll continue in our service. Well, and just, gosh, my voice.
Sorry.
Excuse me. I got your attention. That worked. Hey, it's good to be with you. In a moment, our lead pastor, Brian Mowry, will come up and and share a few things and introduce our speaker today. But before we get to that, we get to welcome in some new members to the Jubilee family, which we love to do. It's such a good reminder that God is building his church, and we're so thankful for every single person that comes through our doors, finds their way to Growth Track and says, hey, this is where I want to be. This is my home. This is where I want to plant my feet, where I want to know people and I want to be known by people. And we definitely want to invite you, because Growth Track is coming up here in a couple weeks. Joel, can you tell us a little bit about Growth Track?
Of course. So Growth Track is a three-step class where we tell you who we're about, what we're about, what we believe. It's a time where you can ask questions about who we're about, what we believe. And it meets, it'll meet in the first Sunday in October. It'll be upstairs during the 10:30 service. And so it's just a good opportunity for you to learn some things. And it sounds really academic, but it's really about you finding family.
Yeah.
How many of you have been through Growth Track? You know, when my awesome wife and I were just discovering if this is the place the Lord had for us, it wasn't so much like bullet points of what people were saying. It was the spirit in how they were saying it and what we learned about the spirit of this family. And so that really drew us in. And so I really encourage you to check it out if there's any interest in just joining us. We'd love for you to do that. And you can, if you have any questions, you can go out to the Connect Point. They'll answer any questions you have. Or there's a spot on your Connect card, and you can throw it in the little black box on your way out.
Right. And this is about finding family. 1 Peter 2 tells us that we are being built up like living stones. And it says that God is building a spiritual house. And as we draw near to him, he is drawing us near to one another. We don't have one or the other happen. They happen. If we're going after God, we inevitably go after people who are following after God and knitting us together. So we have some family members we want to introduce to you. We got a picture up here that's going to go up on the screen from across our locations. This morning, we're welcoming in Andrew and Alex Moulton. Many of you know the Moulton family. Heather Hawk, Jamie and Rachel Teehee, and Nathan and Hannah Albro, which are here with us. Nathan and Hannah, come on up to the stage. Make your way up here, guys. Just a few of them. I want to invite up the location elders as well. We just like to take a moment for those of in our service just to take a moment and pray a blessing over families that have said, hey, Jubilee is our home. We call this a member recognition, so we're really recognizing what they already are. They've been a part of us. They've built relationships here. Like Joel said, they've gone through Growth Track, but they're really finding family here, and we want to come around them. We want to bless them, pray for them, spur them on, pray for their kids. And so we're just going to pray, and I ask you, church, would you just agree with me in prayer as we ask God to bless this family? Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we just thank you so much for the Albros. We thank you for these precious kids. What a blessing, Lord, that they are. God, we pray for their children, Lord, that they would grow up to be mighty men and mighty women of God in your kingdom. God, we believe that you have big things for them in their future. Lord, that you're going to work through them by your spirit to influence others. Believe that over them, Lord. We thank you for Nathan and Hannah. God, we thank you for the gift that they are to Jubilee. We recognize that. We say thank you. We are so much better because they're here and a part of us. Lord, and as their family, we want to gather around them and say and encourage them, bless them. Lord, see them walk in all the good works that you have laid before them, God. So we ask you, Holy Spirit, speak clearly to them, empower them for the things that you have in the days ahead, and we just thank you. We thank you so much for this precious family. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. And all the church said, amen. Amen. Let's thank God. Thank you, guys. Thank you. We love God seeing him build his church. Well, I want to invite up and welcome our lead pastor, Brian Mowry. Let's welcome Brian.
Good morning. Before I introduce my good friend Vinu, who's going to be speaking today, I want to talk a little bit about the Multiply campaign. You have this card that is in your chair. It tells you an overview. And there's some more information on the table back there. And the most important piece of information that you could grab actually is a QR code that will take you to a website where everything's there. And I really do hope that you take the time to go through that. There's a guidebook that takes you through our history and more details about what we hoped it to be. But what multiply is exactly what it says up here. God, we believe that God is calling us to a season of multiplication, a season of trusting him is that we open up what's in our hands, what's in our lives. He's going to multiply joy in our hearts and advance his kingdom through his church. And one of the things that you see when you open up the pages of the New Testament in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 2, and we desire to be a people of the book, to do what we see in the Bible, to follow Jesus, is that we see, you know, this glorious picture. They're, you know, having favor, they're loving each other, they're doing community, breaking bread. And it says in Acts 42, 47, the Lord added to their number daily. And adding people is amazing. In fact, I love all the new members that have just been, that we recognize today that have been added. We've added upwards of like 100 members so far this year through August in all four of our locations. There's more than 1,100 people gathering every week. And I love seeing people added. And it'd be really tempting for us just to kind of park there in Acts 2. We could just park there and we're loving each other and we're seeing people added and, you know, high fives all around. But the book of Acts continues, and the idea wasn't just to add people, but it was to see the church multiply. Jesus said, don't just take this to Jerusalem, but Judea, Samaria, the ends of the earth. And Acts 9:31, that grace fell upon this church in Judea, Samaria, and Jerusalem, and it multiplied. And so the question before us is, will we be content to stay where we're at, or will we turn the page? Will we continue to move forward in what God would have us to do and not just merely exist? And so it's a contending for multiplication to see what we see in the book of Acts. And this is less about what we do and more about who we are becoming. And we want to be faithful disciples of Jesus. And this is all going to culminate. It's starting today. It's all going to culminate in October 27th, All Church Weekend, and on that Saturday, the 5th, we'll gather at Kirkwood High School for a big prayer meeting of all of our locations, and then on Sunday, we'll have a joint service, and then some lunch, and some fun, and it'll be great, and we're asking the church, can everyone take a step forward in their faith? This is what I'm believing for my life. This is what I'm believing for us together. What am I seeing? Everyone take a step forward in their faith. Everyone take a step forward in their influence. God has given you gifts, and as you use those gifts, you can help lead people toward a relationship with Jesus and to take a step forward in your generosity. And it just so happens that in the providence of God that Venu was here today. I don't know of anyone more who has a gift of faith than him. So if we need to grow in our faith, Venu is the man for the hour. And so it's so good to have him here. He's a dear friend. I've known him for more than a decade. He leads an influential church in Mumbai, India, and oversees a family of churches, several hundred churches, over 17 different nations. And we all serve together in our broader family of New Frontiers. He does a lot of what I do. He just does it better. He's 10 years older, and he looks 10 years younger. I mean, it's just, and the advantages just keep on going from there. So would you welcome my good friend, Venu?
Good morning. First thing first, I'm a Cardinal fan. I just said that for my own safety. Brian and Rachel, thank you for having Julie and I. 2018, I was on a sabbatical, so we came here with our two sons. And at that time, Brian drove us here in this very place and showed us the land. The building was in there. And today it is a reality. So congratulations. That's a step of faith. Well done. And we just enjoy your love and fellowship. I want to thank you for that. We come from a nation which has got 1.4 billion people. I'm sure you worked it out how many that would be. And the city that we are part of, we serve, has 22 million people. So there is something that we don't lack in our nation, is people. They are everywhere. And the other thing we don't lack is noise. We make a lot of noise. And you will find that out as I continue to preach. So, feel free to say amen, hallelujah. Those words, I will not be offended. I want to thank you for the season that you are ushering into, multiply. It's a great word. Is there in the Bible? The church multiplied. And for some reasons, the church has stopped multiplying. And I'm so happy that you are entering into that season where you're re-looking at multiplication. So I'm going to dive straight into the word. And as a mark of respect to the word, I would really like you to stand as I read. And then when I finish praying, maybe you can all sit down. Romans 1, 8 to 18. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is being reported all over the world. God, whom I serve in my spirit in preaching the gospel of his Son, is my witness how I constantly remember you in my prayers at all times. And I pray that now, at last, by God's will, the way may be opened for me to come to you. I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gifts to make you strong. That is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that I plan many times to come to you, but have been prevented from doing so until now, in order that I might have a harvest among you just as I have had among the other Gentiles. I'm obligated both to Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish. That is why I am so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jews, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. Father, we thank you for your word. We understand the passion in which Paul lived to proclaim this gospel. Now, Lord, I pray as we unpack this portion of scripture, would you cause the same passion, if not more, put in our hearts so that we will understand the urgency and the eagerness to proclaim the gospel and to multiply, to plant churches. And Lord, help us, we pray, as we hear your word. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated, please. When you read the book of Romans, particularly from this passage, there are a few words that really stood out for me. And I want to help you understand how those words are important for us even now. He said, how I constantly remember you. He is not with them physically. He is far away. He wanted to be with the church, but never happened. And he is still hoping that it is going to happen. Finally, the doors may be opened for me to come. But he's saying, I constantly remember. It is a good thing. We are part of a global family called New Frontiers, Confluence, Commission, Christ Central. And, you know, so many different spheres working together. And I'm sure sometimes you hear stories that are coming from different parts of our world. But it's good to pray and constantly remember our brothers and sisters. Some are in very difficult place, still making a difference with the gospel. And he desires that doors may be opened. That's something that really stood out for me. Doors may be opened. I'm not there with you yet, but I'm hoping that doors may be opened. Why? Because I might have a harvest among you. Paul is not physically with them. He's in prison and he's desiring that when I come to you, I might have a harvest among you. Then he says, I'm obligated. I'm obligated. How often do you feel obligated to preach the gospel? I never used to feel that way. I was happy with my local church. Especially when you read that book, the local church is the really expression of the gospel, and you know you want to see things happening with the local church, and you want to really help your local church. You want to make them happy. You do programs for them, various things, and I want to say well done, keep them happy. But that's not the only aim. We want them happy and come back and engage in mission. So he feels there is an obligation to go there and preach the gospel. And then he said, I am so eager to preach. I'm obligated. I'm so eager. We have 1.4 billion people in our nation. There are some places, the most unreached place perhaps on the planet of earth, with the gospel. The national census says that 2.3% of India is Christians. That's not much compared to 1.4 billion people. But there are some very difficult places for gospel to go through. But I feel there's an obligation to go to those places, make that as our new frontiers. And he says, I am not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed. Because it is the power of God unto salvation for all who believe. Amen? Amen. Now, when you hear this, maybe some of you may be thinking, I've heard this before. I even participated in it. You're talking about church growth, sending missionaries, and I've been involved in all these kind of things. I'm not in it anymore. I don't want to. I just want to be part of a local church. I realize that you may have gone through a situation that held you back. Let me assure you, brothers and sisters, there's someone who's gone through a much worse situation than yours. His name is Elijah. When he did one of the most unthinkable thing of calling fire from heaven on the sacrifice to be consumed. Fire came. And after that, he slaughtered 450 false prophets. If anyone talk about victory, that one goes right on top. Yes or no? I mean, I always forget about the fire coming down. I wondered how he managed to slaughter 450. Did they all line up? Oh, it's my turn. Slaughter me. How did he manage to do that? I think the biggest miracle is that than the fire coming down. That was from God. This one is from him. And soon after that, his name came in the most wanted in the nation. King Ahab and Jezebel said, he is the most wanted person. Look out. notice for everyone. Everyone, look out notice for Elijah. And Elijah got frightened and he ran away and hid himself in a cave. And it says the angel of the Lord came a second time. And I felt there are people, you feel that I've done this, been there, and you don't want to venture anymore. That angel of the Lord coming to Elijah for the second time was grace. Was grace. God's sheer grace upon a man who had passion. He said, I was too zealous for God. If you were too zealous for God and things happened, didn't happen the way you thought, and you are backing off, the grace of God coming to you a second time as you hear this word. You must respond to him. He loves us. He loves you. He loves his church. And the grace of God comes to you again a second time. And what was that grace for? Elijah, what are you doing here? Get up. You need to anoint the future king. And you need to have your successor, Elijah, be anointed as well. There is work to be done, brothers and sisters. Our feelings and emotions, yes, there is a place. And God sends his messenger a second time and say that, you know, rise up. You have work to do. Famous Martin Lloyd-Jones, one of the greatest Bible expository preachers that we have heard, he said, our business is to proclaim the gospel and to bring the message of salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ to all men, to announce the glorious fact that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. You may be a student. You may be an office goer. You may be a businessman, a woman, or you may be a housewife. You may be retired. Wherever we are, your business and my business to proclaim the gospel will never end. We ought to be a witness for Jesus Christ wherever we are. Can I hear an amen? Amen. So here is a question for you. As you are entering into the season of multiplication, how big is your vision? How big is your vision for multiplication? I'm in that phase of my life. Brian said I'm 10 years older than him. I don't look that way. I know you know that. He looks older than me. But he's younger than me. But we are in that phase. We just feel, I don't like the addition symbol. I like the sound of multiplication. We need to believe. We have one life. We want to see lives multiplied in terms of people coming to Christ. We want to see churches multiplied. We want to see nations, our influence into gospel influence, gospel going into nations multiplied. So, what is your vision? John Knox, a Scottish reformer, he said, give me Scotland or I will die. We don't make those prayers anymore. Give me Scotland or I will die. That was his vision. Question. Do you make that kind of prayer? Or can you start thinking, how do you make that kind of prayer? God, give me Missouri or I will die. Give me Kansas or I will die. Give me Washington or I will die. Give me California or I will die. Give me America or I will die. For me and for us, give me India or I will die. Now, I don't necessarily imagine that or in my lifetime, India would be completely transformed. If that happens, I'll see you in heaven. But we must cultivate that desire and the passion to make such big prayers in our lifetime. Your nation has a rich legacy of sending missionaries, sending financially supporting and many people around the world. And we are benefited from that already. But I do believe as much as our nation needs Jesus Christ, your nation needs Jesus Christ. Your nation needs to see churches, more churches planted than ever before. We live in a time where church is not something people who are eagerly say, oh, I want to go to church. No, they are not looking for that. Right in the midst of it, we must make prayers like John Knox. Give me America or I will die. Many years ago, a man drove from Mumbai city to another neighboring state, to another city. Normally such journey would take 8 to 10 hours drive. But this drive took 15 days. Not because we have slow cars. It happened at a time where you change the gear. You remember that? Those days? Some of you still do it. Most of you drive automatic cars. But this man, he said it took 15 days for him because when he learned driving, his grandfather taught him how to drive. He taught him on first gear. And he drove the entire journey in first gear. That's funny, right? And you may think that that happens only in India. It's true. It happens in India. It happened in India. But when I heard that story, I felt this. Isn't that the way we look at church sometimes? I have always done it this way. My parents did it this way. My former pastor did it this way. My grandmother did it this way. We prayed this way. We read the Bible this way. We gave this much this way. And I believe if we want to see multiplication, it is time that we shift the gear. There are few more gears, second, third, and fourth, to be explored for a multiplication. And we want to see that happens in our lifetime. If you and I want to move forward, get ready to shift the gear. What will it take to reach your nation for Christ? John Knox organization have this tagline, this strapline, which says that pray like John Knox and pay like John Knox. Pray like John Knox and pay like John Knox. How about saying that together? Pray like and pray like, pay like John Knox. All right. That was a good try. Can you imagine us praying like that on our knees? On our face down, God, give me America or I will die. And I say, God, I'm willing to pay the price. For some, it's going to be difficult, but I'm saying I'm willing to pay the price. For some, actually paying, I can't go, but I want to give. I want to pay for to see my nation is reached with the gospel. And I find it is a great privilege to come and stand before you to give you that call to participate in a mission because we've been the beneficiary of your generosity at one point. It is now time for us to actually come and encourage you and strengthen you to say that, come on, this gospel must be proclaimed. A story of a man who caught fish. Whenever he caught a big fish, he put it back in the river. And they asked him, why aren't you taking that fish home? He caught a big fish. And he said, I don't have a frying pan big enough to have that fish. I don't have a frying pan. I had, many years ago, when I was leading just one church, my vision was just like a small frying pan. I like small fish. I can look at them, so cute. They're nice. I can eat it. You can taste. This is nice. It's comfortable. I don't need to worry about it. Fits onto my burner. Everything is nice and fitting. And God began to expand my thinking. And my prayer for you, brothers and sisters, this morning, you will begin to have a bigger vision. Now you ask me, what is the size of my frying pan? My frying pan size is this. And I like to catch a fish as big as this to fit into this frying pan so I can fry it. And even if I catch a big one, I will grill it. What is your vision? How big is your frying pan for multiplication? You need to ask God for that. There's a famous prayer offered by Jabez in the Old Testament, 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 10. Oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, and that you, your hand would be with me, and you would keep me from all evil so that I may not cause pain. Oh, that you would bless me and enlarge my territory, enlarge my shoulders. I do have a great responsibility towards the gospel. I have an obligation. In order to do that, I need to see God enlarging my territory. God broadening my shoulders. And that should be for you as well. God, in order to have this vision, to pray like John Knox, to pay like John Knox, give me America or I will die. Make that prayer. God, enlarge my territory. Where I am today, God, give me opportunity. You have people around you, right? Start impacting the gospel. Impacting those people with the gospel. Lord, enlarge my territory. Enlarge my frying pan. How big is your frying pan, brothers and sisters? Can you do this action together today? In faith, this is the size of my frying pan. You can expand it as much as you want. It is your frying pan. Come on, let's do this action. Let's just enlarge this. Yeah, that's it. That's the size of your frying pan. Acts 20, verse 24. Paul's vision. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me. The task of testifying the good news of God's grace. We all have that task. We all have that task. D.L. Moody, he said, it can be done. It ought to be done. And it must be done. Can you repeat after me? It can be done. It ought to be done. And it must be done. Say to your neighbor the same. It can be done. It ought to be done. And it must be done. Wonderful. I heard this analogy of a starfish. Many starfish can reproduce sexually through a process called fragmentation. If a starfish loses a part of its body, it can regenerate the missing parts. And the detached part can sometimes grow into a new starfish. Some species can even intentionally split their bodies in half, with each half regenerating the missing parts to become a complete individual. Complete individual. I believe we all have the potential to multiply. That starfish, sometimes it is an organized multiplication. We plan that. Sometimes it's completely unorganized. But even in that moment, like in the book of Acts, when the persecution increased in Jerusalem, people went as far as Antioch. What happened? A new starfish formed in that place. And I believe we, in the coming days, through this multiplication, we want to see starfish going everywhere. They're fragmenting. They are multiplying. They're shredding their pieces. That grows and become another starfish. Church is multiplying across America. Do you want to see that? Yes. Amen. How many seeds are in an orange? Let me ask you that question. How many seeds are in an orange? Give me a count. 15. Good. It's a big orange. How many oranges are in a seed? You have no idea. Question, you want an orange tree or you want an orchid? An orchard where you can have thousands and thousands of oranges. That seed, we all have the potential to become that seed. How big is your vision? When Jesus called his disciples and gave them the great commandment, this is what he said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age." And those men who had hardly traveled beyond Jerusalem, I don't think anyone traveled more than 100 miles in their entire lifetime. But they were given a global mission. All the nations, all authority has been given, go into every place. And therefore, we need to have that no place left, no people left, no people group left, and no language left. Revelation chapter 7 says, "After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb of God." Every nation, every tribe, every language, no one could count. In church we count because there is a book called Numbers in the Bible. It's great to see 100 people have been added in the last 1 year in the family here. But a day will come, there will be people getting added daily. We want to see that's happening. Because in Acts 9:31 says, "Then the church throughout Judea, Galilee, Samaria enjoyed a time of peace and was strengthened. Living in the fear of the Lord and encouraged by the Holy Spirit, it increased in numbers." Say numbers. Again, Acts chapter 16, verse 5. "So the churches were strengthened in the faith and grew daily in numbers." Say numbers. Numbers. We need to bring that back to the table. It is a biblical thing. Numbers multiplying daily, weekly, monthly, yearly. We want to see that happens. I want to end with this quote. It is the epitaph of John Berridge, a vicar of Everton. A well-known for his directness and theological rich content, John Berridge was an 18th century preacher and a hymn writer. His tombstone in Everton, England reads, "Here lies the earthly remains of John Berridge, late vicar of Everton, an itinerant servant of Jesus Christ who loved his master and his work, and after running on his errands for many years, was called up to wait on him above. Reader, art thou born again? No salvation without new birth. I was born in sin, February 1716, remained ignorant of my fallen state till 1730, lived proudly on faith and works for salvation till 1754, admitted to Everton College 1755, fled to Jesus alone for refuge 1756, fell asleep in Christ January 22nd, 1793. The epitaph of John Berridge captures the journey of faith, emphasizing the necessary necessity of fulfilling our mission, or to know Jesus and make him known in our time. I want to invite you into this journey. We will go back on Wednesday, but I want this message to rest with you. Let it grow in our hearts. Let multiplication happen like a starfish. 1, 2, 3, 4 become numerous. And on that day, around the throne of God, we can say, I was part of that journey. I can see people from every nation, every tribe, every language, because I was faithful to this call. Let's all stand. Father, I thank you for this word. I want to pray, God, this word, not only that go deep in our hearts, but Lord, I pray it will bear fruit. Lord, increase our faith to believe this word is true and it can happen even today. People like John Knox, people like D.L. Moody, people like John Berridge, all these men, they believed and they perceived. And I pray, God, we will believe this word and we will continue to do that. And I pray, God, even anyone is feeling that this is a second call for me, and I pray they will hear this grace call and they will respond to that call. So be upon us as a church, be upon us as a movement. Lord, in our lifetime, we want to make this gospel count. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Celebrating as we have a baptism this morning. So I'm going to have you take a seat and direct your attention to my right, your left.
Hello, hello. Hey, in just a moment, and we get to celebrate two baptisms this morning. Paxton and Aiden are getting baptized. This is special for their families. Yeah, you can cheer. Two of our youth boys. And if you're wondering what's happening, we like to bring the kids in as much as we can to experience these stories and these baptisms. I went to youth camp this year. I know I'm too old, but I went. And this is special for me because Aiden and Paxton were both in like my small group throughout the week. And so I got to see really God have an impact in their life like as that week progressed. If you're new with us, I just want to briefly explain baptism. We believe firmly, as Paul writes in Ephesians, that we are saved by grace through faith. And even that, he says, is a gift of God. So we believe that salvation, our place in heaven happens by believing that Jesus is the Son of God, confessing that and following him.
And it's 100% his work on the cross, his finished work on the cross, and then faith in our heart. And then baptism is just a demonstration of that faith. In fact, it's our first step of obedience. Jesus told his disciples, go make disciples and baptize them. And when we baptize someone, when they go under the water, it represents they had a life that was separated from God. And that life is now buried and gone and dead, just as Christ was buried in the tomb, in the grave. But Jesus raised to life. And when they come out of the water, it represents that they have received this new life in Christ, one that they cannot be separated from. We love that Paul pens that language in the book of Romans, saying that nothing can separate us from the love of God. And so we celebrate that today. So this is really a celebration for Paxton as he obeys God and follows in obedience through faith in him. And his parents are going to share something briefly, and then Paxton's going to actually share his story. So,
Paxton, since you were little, you have been such a curious boy from the beginning, asking what and why about everything. And as I've gotten to see that continue as you've matured, you don't take anything for at face value. You always want to know more. What is the reason? Why is it happening? Help me to explain. I want to understand. And it's been so sweet to watch you on this journey, to ask the questions, to really want to know who Jesus is, why we should love him, what has he done for us. And I just know that that is a gift that God has given you, and that he's going to continue to use for your good and for his glory. And just continue to ask those questions, because it's only going to allow the riches and the goodness of God to be revealed to you as he answers those questions for you.
Paxton, you've always been such a, as Mom said, curious and always such a diligent learner. As a father of four kids, it is really amazing how each child can just have a special place in our family and a special place in our heart, unique to their own personality and to their own gift that they bring to the family. And you are such a gift to our family. And as you've grown in faith and watching you come to know Jesus and follow Jesus for yourself, you will be such a gift to the kingdom and to the family of God. And as I was listening to the talk this morning, just thinking, how many oranges are in a seed, and how many oranges may be planted with you as planting seeds. So we just are excited to invite you and welcome you into the kingdom of God in a new and special way as part of this family, as you've always been a special part of our family. So we're excited. Do you want to share your story here?
My whole life, I grew up in a Christian home. We went to church on Sundays, we went to community group during the week, and we read the children's Bible together every night before bed, and it was normal to talk about God. I also went to a Lutheran elementary school. We went to chapel and talked about Jesus there too. Even during all of these things, I thought of Jesus as just another person in the Bible. The Bible just felt like stories, and Jesus just felt like another thing to learn. Jesus was like another school subject. I just went to church, but never really thought that much about a personal relationship with Jesus. These past 2 years at youth camp, talking with friends and counselors in small groups, I started to learn and realize that Jesus loves me and he wants me to love him too. I learned why Jesus wants to be part of my life. He's not just someone to learn about, but he's someone to know and love. I started to realize that he saved me from my sins, and that Jesus has a purpose for everyone, and he has a purpose for me. I used to worry about so much, and now I worry less because I trust his plans for my life. I now know that Jesus died for my sins and forgives me. He's not just another person. I now believe in him as my personal savior and know that Jesus loves me and wants me to follow him. I want to be baptized to show that I love Jesus and want to follow him the rest of my life.
I feel like you just said this, but let's ask the question anyways. Do you receive Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Then it is our joy to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Aiden, come on up, buddy. Y'all okay if we do one more?
Yeah.
I know you were ready to worship, but we got one more. Come on, Aiden. Yeah. There you go. And just face that way. There you go. Sit right on that crate. Man, just can't, so proud of these guys. This is not an easy thing for them. I know Paxton and Aiden, both of them, is like, oh, getting in front of all those people. But man, it actually underlines that they really want to follow Jesus. Can we just give praise for that? All right, Jessica.
Yeah. There's really so much more that I want to say. So just to add on before I use this little tiny piece, when Aiden was in my womb, I called him my little Spitfire because he was just so active and just go, go, go. And before we, you know, before I came to Christ and now just watching him, watching you trust God, even through the whole background of not having him firmly through that whole time is just so incredible. And you motivate me. And you get to be an example and you get to multiply in the future and you just get to stand firmly on faith. And I just could not be more proud right now because this is the most important thing. And I can't bring riches to heaven, but I can hope in seeing you in heaven. And that is the most important treasure that I could hope to ever bring. And so we get to just, you know, do this with you today. And so, so to almost keep it short and to the point, because we are so excited, we are just overjoyed for the decision that you've made to accept Jesus and follow him. We love you no more and no less because of this choice, but we do know that God will do an incredible work through you. And we are beyond blessed to call you son and will continue to raise you in him to edify you and to encourage you and just praise God for moving your heart.
And we both want to say that we're proud of you for being bold and stepping out in your faith.
Yeah.
And showing everyone that you have the courage to accept Jesus and be bold in your faith moving forward.
And then Aiden's.
All right. Like, my name is Aiden, and I've been going to Jubilee for a year. Before I put my faith into Jesus, I thought that since I didn't have a connection with him, people would look down on me for it. Since coming to church more often and learning more about Jesus, I realized that people don't look down on me. They just want to help me have a stable connection with Jesus. One night after church, I prayed in bed for Jesus to help me know him more and have a relationship with him. I asked Jesus to come into my heart. The next day, I felt a change of heart, and I felt different. I realized that he changed me, and I have been better because of him. Since he entered my heart, I realized he was real. I want to put my life towards him. Jesus has made me feel spiritually free. I believe Jesus died on the cross for my sins and rose from the dead.
We're coordinating. They're going to baptize them together here.
All right, Aiden, do you accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes.
All right, then we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
All right. Praise God. Come on. Watch your step, buddy. You did so good. You did so good. I want to invite you at this time. There will be a diagram on the screen, but there are communion elements on tables to my left and right. If you'll come forward, grab those, return to your seat. We'll receive communion together in just a moment, and then I'll pray for us. So if you have faith in Jesus, if you believe that he is God and he died for your sins, we invite you to participate and receive communion with us. Let's continue to sing. We're going to receive communion, and in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus is with his disciples, and he says he takes bread and he breaks it, and he says, "Do this in remembrance of me. remember the body that was broken for you. And they take a cup and they drink of it. And he says the same thing. Do this in remembrance of the blood poured out. We receive communion. We are remembering what we actually, the joy that we just celebrated with these baptisms. Christ has saved us. Christ has paid the unpayable debt. We fall short, but his grace is sufficient. He has done what only he can do. We don't stand on our own merits. We don't puff ourselves up like we're somehow better than the next person. We all fall short, but by the grace of God, by the riches of his mercy, we have found faith in Christ. He has forgiven us. So we remember, and we need to remember and remind ourselves continually that we are saved by what Christ did on the cross for us. So church, receive and remember what Christ has done. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to pray for us and kind of conclude our time here, but there's a team of people to my left and your right who would love to pray for you, love to encourage you today, however you have need, whether it was something in the service that God spoke to you about this morning. Maybe you're here and you know that God is pressing something upon you. Maybe you've been discouraged. Maybe you know someone who is sick, whatever it is. Would encourage you to respond to that. Receive prayer. When we pray, God hears. God moves. It's a powerful thing. But let me pray for all of us and then we'll go. But the team will linger and the band will linger, and I would encourage you not to miss however God is leading you this morning. Jesus, we thank you so much that you gave your life on the cross for us. We thank you even more that you resurrected 3 days later, conquering Satan, sin, and death. We thank you, Lord, that you sent your disciples, not as orphans, but full of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, we see this playing out throughout the New Testament. Your church filled with your Spirit, going on and going to the next town, in the next town, sharing the gospel. Wherever they are, sharing the gospel, planting seeds that bear fruit. And we want to be a church. We want to be a family. We want to be a people that bears gospel fruit. That is not a cul-de-sac of God's love and power, but a conduit that receives and sends out, God, ambassadors of Christ, confessing the name of Jesus, telling the good news. That's what the gospel is. It's good news. There's a God in heaven who loves you, died for you, gave his life so that you may walk in freedom. Lord, may it be ever ready on our lips to tell people the good news of what you have done. Multiply us, Jesus. Multiply your word in people's lives. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you again for being with us. Prayer team up at the front. Have a wonderful rest of your Sunday.